This is Wimbledon, the oldest Grand Slam tournament and the home of British tennis. But before Andy Murray's victory in 2013, it was nearly 40 years since the last UK resident, Virginia Wade, won Wimbledon. That's a shame for a country that invented the sport. There are hundreds of young, talented players in the UK. They give a hope that decades of constant failures will be over, but why there is yet a struggle to reach the top.
Great Britain didn't invest in its junior programs the way some of the other countries did, perhaps?
It's quite a lot of money in tennis. I think you have to be rich to do it. Maybe that's part of the problem.
I don't think we're as dedicated at sport in England as some other countries.
We don't have the greatest weather, so I think we need more indoor facilities.
Because the British people, they love Wimbledon, they don't love tennis. That's the reason.
Indeed, it is difficult to love sport when facilities are poor. This is Sheffield and District Lawn Tennis Association, by the way, the first tennis association in the world. But local conditions hardly attract many tennis enthusiasts, unless they have the privilege of being a club member.
I think pretty quickly, as soon as you get outside of a club environment, facilities are pretty poor. If you're not willing and able to pay for something like this, then you're going to be down to sort of courts on a park somewhere, which might be quality, may not be very good. So it's, you know, it becomes a cycle, doesn't it? I mean, if we haven't got the heritage of it, people don't play it, we don't get successful at it, so people don't play it, and it goes on and on. Obviously, people are trying to address that. There's been so much money and strategy put into tennis for years. It just makes you realise how slow these things are to change and to become part of the public consciousness of we can do that. So it takes a while, doesn't it? It's improving, but it's still a little bit exclusive.
Parks tennis in across the country has been in decline for probably 25 to 30 years, and a lot of the courts are in poor condition. There's around 80 parks in Sheffield, and I think there's 21 parks that have tennis courts. The problem has been is that as local authorities have been subject to cutbacks over the last 20 plus years, they've not really had the money to put into maintaining the parks courts. If the local authority is willing to put some money in, then the LTA may match that. So that will then give us an amount where we can resurface the courts or repaint the courts, bring them up back up to a good condition. We've done that with two parks in Sheffield already. We have got another couple of sites that we're looking to do. I'm also working in Hull. So really we're starting to make some inroads in improving the condition of public tennis facilities. But we'll also provide people with information on the opportunities that are available within club venues. So if they want to keep playing, there is a sort of route for them to go into, you know, whether it be somewhere like Hallamshire or Graves or any of the other clubs, that so they play on an all-year-round basis.
Statistics says that there are almost 700,000 people in the UK who play tennis at least once a month, and they're all in the roof once summer days are over and rainy British weather is back. That means pay for a club membership or find a cheaper sport.
Within the UK, our climate sometimes maybe doesn't help, especially through the winter months, and then indoor courts become a bit more expensive, and you know, trying to just get court time becomes a bit of an issue, so facilities are important. But I think for sure there's a much better base and a much better structure now than there was 10 years ago.
The LTA has spent more than £30,000 on facilities over the past 5 years. Here at the Graves Tennis Centre, they are spending £16 million on two new indoor courts and other grounds repairs. Even if with Andy Murray's success people were inspired to play more frequently, tennis still hasn't lost its middle-class image and fees keep going up.
For a rich country, a relatively rich country, facilities are generally pretty poor unless you're willing to pay for them. I mean, obviously you can come down here to a lovely tennis club, great facilities, great coaches, great environment, but of course you're paying for it, and that obviously excludes many people who haven't got the money or don't want to spend the limited money on these sort of facilities.
The average price of the full adult annual membership is £250 and £100 for a junior. And that's excluding fees for entrance when joining, floodlight and court booking fees in addition to a membership. The LTA is claiming they're trying to change the culture of tennis in Britain, but they should better try to make affordably priced indoor conditions first, especially if they're waiting for a new Andy Murray.
There's lots of facilities. Obviously, the cost is an issue. Now, luckily, we've only got one child, so it's easier for us. But if you've got two or three children, how do you balance that off? Something's got to give, and it's probably that child may well have to suffer as a result. Or if you haven't got any money, then again, it suffers, and it seems a crazy system, really. Putting the money at the top end, obviously, instantly, you've sliced off all that potential talent that could have been there beforehand. Mm-hmm. So, and it doesn't take a great genius sometimes to work out where British tennis is going wrong.
There is a vicious circle. Players and parents criticize the system for its poor administration. Tennis officials blame the players for not enough commitment to the game. British hopefuls often give up playing or move abroad to continue their professional tennis career. And it's not all about the money.
And then be like better than like, so let's say Sabrina Williams.
I'd love to win Wimbledon, but just be having the chance to be on Wimbledon would be a big honour.
You know, I think it might be a little bit too far-fetched, but I think it would be quite nice to get in.
To win Wimbledon and be famous for playing tennis.
The path to Wimbledon is tough, and even if you got all the money, you can't buy the Champions Trophy. You have to deserve it by being faster, stronger and harder than anyone else. So do British children indeed have a desire to reach the top?
Without stereotyping too much, especially from maybe like Eastern European countries, have maybe not had the opportunities that the players in this country have had, but because they've had to fight a lot more, they have that grit that is required to be the champion, whereas sometimes I feel historically in this country it's very easy for players. They kind of have everything they want really early on, like maybe you see players at turning up to tournaments at 8 years old with a full bag of like four rackets, all the new Nadal tennis gear, and they've got a personal physio, or they get taken to every match, and they don't actually have to really do very much for themselves. So as soon as they get to a stage where it is all about doing it for yourself, how are they expected to cope with that? I think there's a lot of players at the junior level that would still like to get there and really, you know, really strive to get there. But it's very easy in tennis to fall short because there's so many uncontrollable factors that can affect you. It's not just about whether you want it. So sometimes in the media, players say, oh, they don't want it enough or something like that, whereas just wanting it's not really enough anyway to get to the top.
I think they need, obviously, a good attitude. So they need to be positive. They need to have a mindset where, you know, it's not necessarily always about an outcome. It's all about the experience of learning and developing, definitely. I think they need to have good perseverance. They need to stick at the task. They need to understand that tennis is a challenging sport. So definitely for young kids to succeed, good attitude, perseverance, effort over pure talent, definitely.
Ellis Baldwin is only 5 years old, but he already can equally compete against all the players. He started picking up a racket at the age of two, and his mum brought him along to the Abbeydale Tennis Club in Sheffield. Now Ellis plays twice a week and got a lot of potential, especially for his age. But there is still a long way ahead of him. He's only just started school and so far can't focus purely on tennis. that he loves the game and has all the support a child needs at this stage.
I think you should always encourage. If they want to do it, then loads of encouragement to do it. And as you say, if I've got to make sacrifices, then I've got to make the sacrifices. But I think always just encourage, just keep going. And if they want to do it, then brilliant. And as I say, it's all him. I don't push him to do anything. He does a few one-to-one lessons, but that's because he wants to. If he didn't want to do it, I'd be upset probably. But then if it'd have to be up to him, because I think he'd just come a bit, I don't really want to do it, so he wouldn't try.
Another challenging moment in youth tennis is transition from junior to senior tour. Generally, it happens at the age of 12. At this stage, tennis court has to become a second home, as well as coaching team, a second family.
Being able to deal with the adversity that you're going to experience and being prepared for that, I think, is important as well. What I don't think happens enough is junior players aren't well prepared for the challenges that they're going to face in the senior game. It's almost like we try to rescue them and shelter them from that, whereas actually it would be better to be honest and make sure that they understood exactly what they were going to have to deal with when they make that step up to senior. Aspiring tennis player has to sacrifice, so they've got to get rest, they've got to eat the right things, they've got to limit the amount of time they spend with friends and things like that, just because their lifestyle has to be that of someone who's trying to become an elite athlete.
I used to train 6 days a week, a lot of tournaments as well. So some weeks I would just be travelling in a different country playing tournaments. So one year I did 12 weeks in a row in Europe in different countries. It was tough to balance school and tennis when I was younger because I took a lot of time out of school. So I managed a lot of distance learning, which has just taught me how to discipline myself. And obviously, when your friends are going and socialising a lot, when I had to commit to tennis and training the next morning, for instance, that was hard, but it was worth it, I think. At the moment, I'm just playing tennis for my university up in Durham, and we're doing really well there, actually. We're the number one tennis club in the country. So I just hope to continue winning enough matches for them and see where it takes me after university.
As opposed to Jessica, Olivia Noble decided to move to Florida to study sports and exercise science. There, she will be able to get a degree and to continue playing tennis professionally. Whereas here in Great Britain, promising players sometimes have to make a choice, and often it's against tennis.
Yeah, I think it's slightly different in the way that it's quite tough here to do both academic and tennis. It's not something that is really encouraged, but there are certain schemes that you can do to work towards that. But I think definitely at the university level, there is more of a focus on academic than there is sport. Yeah. Definitely, there's lots of universities like Loughborough, Leeds, Beckett. There's lots of places where you can carry on, but it's still very hard. I think personally for me, that juggling was very hard when I was, well, even still now. So I think over in the States, there's just a bit more support around that. They have mentors, they have things like that. Whereas over here, I think we have more of a just kind of figure it out for yourself ethos, which is something that I kind of like being guided. I quite like that in the respect.
Well, I think in America, for instance, they put a lot of emphasis on college. So a lot of people play and then they get a scholarship to American college and continue playing afterwards. Here, we're becoming more like that, actually. A lot of the juniors, especially, are going to America to get a scholarship. So we're losing a few players there. But like I said, a lot of Americans come out of college and play professionally, which is what a lot of British people, British players are doing now also.
I think there's a lot more space in America, first up, so they can build bigger tennis centres, so that means you've got access to more courts, and then I think the tournament structures and the culture of society is a bit different. It's a bit more outside all the time anyway, just families will spend a load more time outside because the climate's there, like I keep saying. So it's just they don't see tennis as something you book in and do, or a tournament you schedule in for the weekend. It's just that's what they do every weekend or every evening anyway.
We're quite a small country, so there's obviously not a lot of room for facilities and stuff. The facilities we have here are absolutely great. I just think it's a struggle. There's only a couple, so it's kind of like the players that aren't near those centres, it's very hard for them to achieve the absolute best because they're obviously not got enough money to get down there. So, and it's quite tough in that respect, in the way that there isn't enough things going on for the tennis players, unfortunately.
You know, it's not the LTA's role on its own to produce the next generation of champions. It's to really help provide a network and work with those kind of centres to make sure they've got the right environment in which to flourish. So it doesn't matter how they get to the top, whether it be this country or another country, as long as we have people coming through that can play and that there is opportunities to, available to try and do that. It's a tough sport. It's a sport that's played in a huge number of countries across the world, so it's not an easy one, but we are making progress in that area, I think.
The LTA are doing a good job. In the press yesterday, it said tennis participation has gone up 12% in the last year, which is pretty impressive for a sport like tennis, where we've kind of talked about the current issues. I think they're seeing that ultimately grassroots is really the way forward, and getting people participating and playing and enjoying tennis is the way where hopefully you will inspire the next Andy Murray, or, you know, if that's their aim, to get professional tennis players, that will happen.
Like the tennis system is really improving, slowly but surely. Courts have been refurbished, free parks tennis with various programs, promising juniors get more attention. But whether there are British heroes are coming through to the top of the world tennis, only time will show.